Hello, everybody. Thank you for this wonderful introduction. I'm very proud to be here, and thank you very much for the invitation. And everybody, thank you for coming here. It's really nice that you are here. When I was a young student, I thought sleep must be interesting. A lot of people thought, oh, Poul, come on, why don't you just do some research in something we know? But why should we do research in something we know? Why not do research in something we don't know? And I know there's a lot of young people here thinking about what should I do in my life. I think you should explore things we don't know. I think this is very nice. And what we actually learned in this period is that we actually don't know very much about why we sleep. But now we know much more. And I would take you into a story in the brain to explore and tell you a story about how we sleep and why we sleep and why we dream. I don't have all answers, so there are many things to be explored, also by you and some of you, and there are many questions that we have not yet addressed, but we know more than we did for 20 years ago. So I will take you into this story, and of course, I cannot fulfill the film, which you just saw here, but I will take you into some moments where we actually do think and why we sleep and why we dream. So my first question to you, how much do you sleep? We don't have a voting here, but think about it and think, how much do you think you sleep every day, including the weekend, how much do you sleep? So think about it. Are you here or are you there? Do you sleep 6 hours, 5 hours, 8 hours, 9 hours, 10 hours? Think about it. What we actually discovered in the last years is that we sleep less. If we do basic population-based studies, we see that we sleep less. It's a trend that we see all over the world, and also independent of age, we tend to sleep less. There is a risk here, because this is self-reported sleeping, so we don't know with objective method whether this is correct. But a lot of studies show, in general, that we tend to sleep less with development of our society. And you can see here, in different ages, that independent of ages, we tend to sleep less as compared to former times, and that accounts to many ages. So what is this, and what is the story about sleep? If we want to study sleep, we have to go back in history. And this is a picture of an old neurologist. He's not living any longer. He's called von Economo. He was a very, very famous neurologist. And what he discovered was that in the beginning or after the World War II, there was a disease which spread very rapidly, and people tend to sleep very much, up to more than 20 hours per day. So they tend to fall asleep. And nobody actually knew what that disease was. And there has been a long discussion what it was. But what he discovered was that in the brainstem, for those who actually died after the disease, there was some specific lesion in the brainstem, and this is the brainstem area in the brain, and he discovered there were some changes in this brainstem area in those who died, and some of them did not sleep much, and some did sleep very much before they died. So he had this discovery, and he thought there must be a system originating from the brainstem area which in some way awakenings the brain or activating the brain. And this was a very important discovery because this system is very basic to all of us. And we call this system today, we call it the ascending arousal system. It's the most important system in our brain. It originates in the brainstem areas and spread information up to other parts of the brain. There are two major division of the system. One is going to thalamus. Thalamus is a very important system where all your sensory and motor system is going through and is modified. And then another system is going via a region here called hypothalamus and spread. It's an activating system. It wakes up your brain. It's a complicated system. It consists of a lot of neurons, a lot of nuclei, a lot of brain cells. But it activates your brain. And a lot of a lot of neurotransmitters are involved in this. The GABA system, which we know for sleeping pills, the histamines, which you know if you get dizzy, and the tryptophan system, which you know from antidepressants and so forth. Many of these drugs, many drugs works on this system. So it's a very, very important system. And if you lesion the system, you will interfere with wakefulness. So it's an activating system or the arousing system. So we have to learn that. That's the first part. So in wakefulness, this system is active. But the information from Ekonomo was very quiet for many years. But in the 90s at the Harvard University, Clifford Tabor and his group discovered that another nuclei in the most anterior or in the first part of the hypothalamus, there was a group of cells, and when they were active, this system was not active, and when this system was active, this system was not active. So in some way there was some inhibition of these two systems. One system was inhibiting the other system. So we thought there must be a connection here. There must be something between this system and this system. Because when this is active, nothing is happening there. And when this is active, nothing is happening there. So he proposed that there should be a connection between this system. And when you have animals, what do you do? He took a knife. He took a knife and he made a cut. And this is not simple because the animal is small and you know how to be very precise and so forth. But basically what he did, he cut here. So he had electrodes in the animal and had electrodes there, and he had electrodes in these nuclei. And he noticed that if he made this cut, the two system was working independent. And furthermore, the animal did not sleep. So in some way, this was a system for sleep. The system, when it's active, inhibit the activating system. So it's actively inhibiting the activating system. So that was the very first heart of it. But he also noticed another thing, that this system in some way could not inhibit the other system. So it was both ways. So we now have a system what we call a flip-flop. A flip-flop system is something where one promotes the other and vice versa. So we have the sleep nuclei, the VLPO nuclei, and it's a long name because it's called the ventrolateral preoptic nucleus. It's a very long name, and so it is in the brain. Everything has long names, but that's the way it is. So when I was a student, I thought, oh, the brain was very complicated. I will not be a neurologist. And I turned out to be a neurologist, a new physiologist. And then I thought, oh, the brainstem is very complicated. I don't want to go in there. But I ended there. So that's the way how research is. And I don't remember all the names of this region. But it's really complicated, this region. Anyway, so when the sleep nuclei, the VLPO nuclei, is active, we inhibit the arousal system. And when the arousal system is active, you inhibit this system. Okay, that's very nice. You are all awake now, I can see that. But in a while you will fall asleep and you think, oh, Poul, he has a good story, I want to hear about it. So you wake up yourself, and what you do in this situation is that you actually inhibit the sleep system. That is what you do. So it's a very elegant system in the way that it interacts with each other. But the problem is, who should regulate this? Who should be in charge of this system? Who should be in demand of being sleepy or awake? So that was the major problem. So in 98, at Stanford University, and also in Japan, two groups independent of each other discovered another system. And one was the Stanford group, and they called it the hypocretin system. And the other one was the Japanese group, the Sakurai group, who discovered this system. And of course, they actually gave it different names. So it's so that this group called it hypocretin and this one orexin system. And the reason for that is orexin is something about appetite. And this was something else. Basically, they called it orexin. And it's really complicated because in the literature, we use both names. And in my lab, we get interested into that because I thought it was interesting. So in 2010, we started doing research on this. So we can measure this. This is something we can measure. We can take a lumbar puncture. And you probably think, what is a lumbar puncture? But it's a puncture where we take a needle and ask the patient to sit with the back to us. And then we tweak the needle and put it into the spine. Oof. So, but then we can take out the fluid from the spine. So it's, and there we can measure the concentration of these signaled. So the signal we can measure in the fluid from the spine, and the spine fluid is coming from the brain. So here we can measure. It's very simple. We could also take it in the brain, but people don't like to have a needle into the brain. You know, it's here in Denmark, people are very sensitive. And I don't understand, but that's the way it is anyway. So we can measure this. But it turned out that we know that this system is facilitating wakefulness. So the system is a wake up system and say, hey, you have to wake up. And stay awake. So it's stabilizing wakefulness. And when we need to sleep, sleep inhibit this system and inhibit the arousal system. So now we have a stabilizer for wakefulness. And this is a very, very important part. So Saber called it the flip-flop. But in my lab, we prefer to call it transition. I think many more people are going into the story about transition. So it's not a true flip-flop, but it's more like you switch from one side to the other or back again. You know, when you tend to fall asleep, you slowly slide into sleep, or when you wake up, you slowly slide back to wakefulness. It's not an on-off mechanism. But anyway, this it's a long discussion, but basically this is something we can measure. It's quite interesting. You can actually measure the activity in these neurons. For instance, Jerry Siegel, in San Diego, he did a very nice study where he actually put electrode into rabbit, male rabbit, orexin neurons. And then he showed that very elegantly, when they wake up, the neuron was active. When they were eating, they were active. And when they saw the female rabbit, it turns out very active. So the system has something to do with wakefulness, feeding, seeking, and reproducibility or reproduction. So the system is also active when we seek for mates. It's also involved in that. So it's quite interesting system, and then also for food. So basically, we have a model now, and we think the model is in fact very simple. We thought for years it was very complicated, but maybe it's relatively simple. So because we have this arousal system, which consists of all these nuclei, and nobody can remember all the names of these nuclei, and I cannot remember at least. Anyway, it's very active when we are awake. But then we have the VLPO system, the sleep system. When we are awake, we have to inhibit this system, and we have to have a stabilizer here. But we need something more. We need light, because the Earth is rotating. So light is influencing the circadian system, which is influencing the wake system, which is stabilizing by the hypocretin system. And when this is on, we turn on the brain, so we switch to wakefulness. So that's the way it works. And when we go to sleep, in some way, we need to sleep, and when that happens, the system is going in and block all the system. And when that happens, the brain goes to sleep. So, is it really that simple? And I realized, and if Jerry Siegel were here, he would say, "Yo, Poul, you know, it's a little bit more complicated." But then I said, "Jerry, yeah, I know, but basically, isn't that true?" And he said, "Yeah, it's true." So that's the way the system actually works in your brain. When you go to sleep, your sleep system will say, okay, I need to block the system, and your brain will go to sleep. That's the way it works. So it is quite interesting. So where can we use this information? Is this at all useful? I mean, who cares? But if this system has influence and is affected by certain diseases, it may be important. And one disease which is very, very important, because I told you about the hypercretin or the orexin system. Why was that important? Because we discovered in 2000 that in patients with the disease narcolepsy, have you heard about the disease narcolepsy? What is it? It's a group of patients who tends to fall asleep and they cannot control it. You know, it's young patients who get it very early in life, typically 8, 12 years old, and they get it very rapidly, and they have it chronically for the rest of their life. So what is wrong in that system? The things we know today is that we have this orexin or hypercretin system. It facilitates wake and sleep. But in that patient, this system is blocked. It's broken down. The neurons who produce orexin or hypercretin, they are being destroyed. So the patient cannot regulate the system, so we destabilize the flip-flop mechanism or the transition system, so the patient cannot control wakefulness any longer. But also, which is very interesting, so they cannot control wake-sleep rhythm, but they have other problems. They cannot control REM sleep and non-REM sleep, dream sleep and non-dream sleep. So they get a lot of hallucination. And this is very, very, very provocative for the patients, because they have a lot of dream hallucination. For instance, a young person who, in my lab for a few days ago, he was 8 years old, and he told me, you know, when I'm sitting in school, when I should read to the teacher, I see a lot of hallucination. And when I'm sitting with my friends, I feel something. Someone is touching my legs, and you know, I look at it, and I cannot see anybody touching my legs. And I ask him, "Do you hear some voices?" "Yeah, when I'm alone, I hear some voices." And the problem for him is that the system is destabilized, so he switched so much, and even to REM sleep directly, so he go directly into dream in consciousness. So he has this problem that the switch is so fast and rapid that he even cannot not only control sleep-wake and wake-sleep, but he cannot even control dream-non-dream. So this is part of the disease. So he has what we call hypnagogic hallucination. It's a very complex experience for those who have this. We all have it when we are very sleepy and so forth, but these patients have it constantly, and it's very, very annoying. And then it's a real problem. And then he has some other thing else, which is typical for the patient. You can find a lot of videos for this. People who just tend to fall when they laugh or something, they fall, they lose their muscle activity, and we call that cataplexy. And because the system is not only controlling sleep-wake, non-REM-REM, but also control motor tonus. So it's a very complex disease for those who actually have it. Another classical example, just where we can use it, is in patients who experience insomnia, difficulty in falling asleep. We know that this system is in some way destabilized, but personally I think, and this is something we discussed very much with in between Dieter Riemann, who was one of the researchers working with this model in insomnia, we think more and more that it's not only a destabilization, but it's an increased arousability in the system. So those who experience chronic insomnia or sleep difficulties, they feel that they have an increased arousability. One funny part of this story is actually that males tend to have less arousability in sleep. And I think many women know that, especially if you are children. And women tend to have more arousability. They wake up even easier than males if they have children who cry or something like that. Or maybe the males do not want to get up and shift the child. But I don't know exactly. But that's another part of the story or the coin here we can talk about. Okay, so, I mean, why should we sleep? Who cares, anyway? But we have to talk about another story. We have to talk about the homeostatic process and the circadian process. You know, you are here, when we are awake, you build up a pressure for sleep. At a certain time, when you fall asleep, you remove this pressure, and next time you fall asleep again, or you're awake, you build up a new pressure for sleep, and when you sleep, you reduce the pressure, and it goes on. And then we have the circadian rhythm, which is going up and down like this, and we have it every day because the rotation of the Earth. Okay, so we should sleep at a certain time, so we remove something when we sleep. Basically, that's what we do. So we remove a process, which we call process S, and we don't know exactly what it is. We have some ideas, but we know some neurotransmitters which are involved, adenosine and maybe hypercretin are involved. And you all drink coffee once in a while, and caffeine is one of the antagonists to this process. So it's a process which is going on. And we can actually measure this. We have biological measures for this process. We can measure it as part of the deep sleep, so we can measure this process. I mention this because it's very important in the understanding of the sleep process. Because when we fall asleep, we tend to have a process where we tend to go into deep sleep, and another period of deep sleep, this is a full sleep period of 8 hours. But then we have this episode here of what we call rapid eye movement sleep. Because when we sleep, we have rapid eye movement sleep. You know, if you look at your person when you look at a person who is sleeping, you will see once in a while they get eye movements, and that is what we call rapid eye movement sleep. It's an active sleep. It means that the brain is active, in contrast to non-rapid eye movement sleep, where the brain is downregulated. And that is what we've seen is part of what we call N1 sleep, which is drowsiness, or light sleep N2, and deep sleep, what we call slow wave sleep. This is a word which is often used. If you go into Wikipedia or whatever, you would see the wording SWS, which means slow wave sleep. It's something we can measure from the brain. It's not complicated. And now you can even, on the web, buy small devices which can measure brain activity. So it's something you can measure, and you also can measure the eye movements and muscle tone. So it's not complicated. We do it every day. It's very, very common. So what are we talking about here? We talk about this process, and I just want to mention the circadian rhythm. The circadian rhythm is very important because when you wake up in the morning, you get light in your eyes, the light inhibit the give information to a nuclei called the suprachiasmatic nuclei, that is the circadian nuclei, and they send a nerve bundle down to the neck and back to the brain into a very small nucleus here in the lower part of the brain, which has a very long name, also named the pineal gland. And do you know what that produces? You know, when I say melatonin, yes, melatonin, yes, you didn't say, but it produces melatonin in the nighttime, and that is a kind of what we call a circadian hormone. So it's a hormone which express rhythmicity. So we have this process. Now we have the process S, which is the sleep, and then the process C, which is the circadian process. So when you are here in the evening, you tend to go to sleep. Maybe the orchestra is very good, so maybe you stay up a little longer. But then when you get to sleep, you will downregulate the need for sleep. And if you have additional sleep pressure because you stay awake, you will have more need to sleep here. So can we measure this? And the answer is quite easy. Yes, we can. Because we can measure the amount of deep sleep here. You can see each of the episode number 1, 2, 3 in the night. And we can measure this. And if we stay up for 2 days, we can see we get longer sleep, more sleep, more deep sleep episode, and more intensity. And you know this, because if you have stayed up for 2 days, you are much more sleepy, and you would like to sleep more. Typically, let's say 10, 12 hours instead of 8 hours. That's a very easy process. And furthermore, if you take a nap, you can downregulate the need for sleep by downregulate this need going down a little bit by having a nap. It's very, very simple. So we talk about a very simple model here. We accept that the neural processes behind this is complicated, but basically the model is simple. So that is what we need. So let's take about some myths. Sleep some people say, I don't need sleep. I almost never sleep. I never sleep at all. Or I only need 4 hours of sleep each day. But in my lab, it's very rare that people sleep less than 5 hours per day. It's very rare that we see these people. They exist. We have some very select cases where they have, for instance, the lesion in the neural path, which I talked about earlier, because they had a brain tumor or something like that. It's a very difficult situation to be in, but it's very, very rare to see people who sleep very little. So let's keep to the facts. Normally, human needs 7 to 8 hours of sleep. And some of you will ask me, is it possible to sleep less? Can I in some way reduce my sleep? Could I get 1 hour more per day, or 2 hours more per day, or even 3 hours more per day? If I could get that, I could do much more. I could type up a report, I could paint another picture, I could do much more if I just had more sleep. So is there any way we can do this? So let's look at the function of sleep. So we actually, many groups have looked at the function of sleep. Some of the early study was done by Rechtschaffen and the colleagues, and they actually did some studies. So how can we study the function of sleep? The best way is to inhibit sleep, because it's a way to do it. I mean, remove the sleep and see what happens. And that is the thing they did. So they developed this method. They had some cages, and what they placed some animals, typically rats, on these platforms. And there are two ways to do it. One is the rotating platform. There are other ways to do it. You can also do it by pain and electrical stimulation. But the most common way to do it is this model, where you, in the experiment animal, you every time the animal falls asleep, they rotate the cage, the plate, and then the animal have to move. So it has to wake up. That's one way to do it. A more not as nice model is this one. You place the animal on a very, very small platform and with water. So every time the animal falls asleep, the head falls into the water and the animal has to wake up. So, you know, it's not that nice. Think about it. If you were on a small platform, you were sitting like this, and every time you fall asleep, you did like this. So, but that's one way to do it, and how to inhibit sleep. So that's the way they actually did. And you can also do it by electrical stimulation, by pain. But pain is really a difficult issue to use. In some way, you inhibit pain by some time. So this is the way they did. And what they found in this experiment was actually nothing happened for the first days or the weeks. But then suddenly after week 3 and especially week 4, they saw that the food intake increased. But strange enough, they saw that the body weight reduced. And here, and after this, up to day 35, the experiment ended. And do you know why? The rats died. Basically, the rats died. Almost none of the rats actually survived 35 hours. There has been very limited number of studies after the first report. It was published in a journal. And very few have actually done this because it is in many ways considered very unethical study. And there has been experiments also in humans, but it's really tough to do these experiments. And also in humans, you have used, especially people have to stand up, but you can't sleep standing up. You have used pain or other things, but it's really difficult to do. And basically, these experiments shows that there is a strong metabolic effect of sleep. And that was one of the factors. So one of the theory of sleep is that sleep is for body restoration. That is one of the first theory of sleep, and that actually was one of the theories which were in some ways supporting this theory. And one other reason for this is that especially growth hormone, especially in the growing child, is very high during slow wave sleep. And this has been noted for many years, and Van Gouter was one of the first to point it out, but actually it was known for since the 80s that growth hormone was increased in sleep, and if you inhibit growth hormone in sleep, the child will not grow. So in some way, there is a very strong interaction. We have a lot of diseases where that happens. For instance, in snoring and children with sleep apnea, they stop growing, and when you treat the sleep apnea, the child begin to grow again. So it's a very, very strong support for this theory. So we have these theory. We have the restoration theory. We have the different people who actually came up with this, and some very strong persons actually came up. Oswald was the first to support this, and he gave suggestions for this. He actually was not a very strong researcher, did not do very much studies, but Jim Horn did a lot of studies in this area, and he's still alive, he's very active still, and suggested that sleep is for restoration, and especially deep sleep or slow wave sleep. Okay, so we know that the restoration theory has a number of support, because if we in some way sleep deprive young people or young animal, we will see deficit, and we will also see that if we deprive sleep, there will be sleep rebound after sleep deprivation. And we can see that in some way we also see that REM sleep in some way are associated with brain growth. We know that for children. I will show you the picture in a short. So there is a very strong support for this theory. So we have this, and we have these experiments in animals, but we also have some experiments. I have to show you this one. We have these experiments also in humans, and one of the most important, and you can find that also, it's described in Wikipedia. The Randy Gardner experiment was done in Stanford University, where he stayed awake, and they actually did also record PhD or EEG data, so they actually showed that he did not sleep in this period. And he was able to stay awake for almost 2 weeks, but he gets some vision problems, and he got hallucination and so forth in the end of the experiment. And the end of the experiment, he slept, I remember, I think it was 14 hours or 20 hours, and then he stayed awake for another 1 day, and then he turned back to his normal procedure. There was a long discussion about, in some way it doesn't work well, there was a long discussion about the ethics of these results, because it was total sleep deprivation for a long period. But there has been a number of studies where we actually deprive for some hours. For instance, we have done a study where we deprive down to 4 hours for a certain period, young people in a metabolic chamber, so where we can study sleep and the metabolic effect of this. But what we can see is that for down to a certain amount of sleep, we can reduce sleep approximately down to 70% without major effect, for instance, on metabolism and so forth. But we talk about short-term experiments. We can do these experiments typically up to, let's say, 1 week. So what about chronic sleep restriction? And that is much more complicated. Before we discuss this, I need to show you what the normal distribution in sleep is. And you can see this is strongly dependent on age. Children need more sleep, and they have typically at least 2 phases of sleep, daytime and nocturnal sleep, and that stops around 4 years of age. That's a typical pattern. So this is one part of it, and the second part of it, you have to remember, that's in the growing child, that especially REM sleep is very dominating. When the child is born, more than 50% of the total sleep time is REM, rapid eye movement sleep, and the rest is slow wave sleep. So REM sleep has specific reasons. We have specific reasons for that, and it decreases by age. So REM sleep and non-REM sleep are necessary, and why? And can we at all separate these two sleep phenomena? We know that there are many, many functions which change in sleep. Metabolism, blood flow, brain processes, bodily function. And you can see, as I told you before, growth hormone increases in sleep. And we have many other functions which really change very much in sleep. So it brings us back to the story about cognition. Is there other reasons for sleep than restoration? And I would say yes, because this was also proposed, for instance, by Crick and Mitchison in 83, but it was further supported by Stickgold and other studies who actually basically suggested that especially REM sleep, but probably also slow-wave sleep, are important for what we call memory consolidation, or ability to remember, or ability to sort out information. So, and this has been one of the dominating theory for sleep since this period. Well, our model is the following. When you are here, you get a lot of information, or you get a lot of information when you are biked to this place, or however you, what you do all day. So in daytime, you and wakefulness, you encode, or you get a lot of information, memory information, but in some way you have to sort it out in relation to what you already know or your information system in your brain. So you need to do a memory consolidation process. You need to sort out important information and store what is needed and throw away what is not necessary. And you have to do it in some way in relation to what you already have of information. And remember, when we talk about memory, we're not talking about formal memory as you can read in a book, not only. But it can also be procedures, biking, walking, playing on a piano, whatever. Memory as a whole is a complex process and consists of many informations. So basically what our biological model is that we build up a need of information, and then we produce this in sleep. And we have physiological process going on, and let's say in slow-wave sleep here, you can see that we have cortical oscillations, which is expressing some new physiological phenomenon, in this case, spindle activity, which is brain waves in the brain, which we can measure, or also in REM sleep, which is in some way expressing synaptic connections, that is small connection in between nerve cells. And I just want to give you a very simple clinical impression of how this means, because we have these spindles, we can measure them on the brain activity, so, and we have experiments which shows that in a learning process, you increase the number of spindles in your brain. So we can measure this on brain cortical areas. We asked the opposite question, okay, if we have patients with major brain diseases where dementia is dominating, could it be so that you also in this process destroy brain areas which are not able to encode or to store memory any longer? So we took patients with, in this case, Parkinson's disease and pre-Parkinson's disease, and this is a disorder called REM sleep behavior disorder, and then we just counted the number of sleep spindles. And we can easily see that with advanced sleep, or with advanced disease, we saw less and less sleep spindle in these cases. So the patient in some way destroyed function where they were able to produce sleep spindle, and it is related to disease advancement, and it further advanced with cognitive dysfunction. So it's a bilateral process, it's related to learning processes, but it's also affected in patients with cognitive diseases. So it's really important. So we have this theory, and remember we are talking about two sleep stages probably have different functions in the memory encoding or memory consolidation process, namely slow-wave sleep and REM sleep. I will not go into deeper into these two sleep stages and the relation to what we call the declarative cognitive function and the procedural function, but basically, I want to talk about how we actually think that it actually is associated. So we think in some way that the memory process is a synaptic process or an active system consolidation. I know this is very complicated, but the turnout of this is, if you think about it, you could say, is my dream something which is controlling my brain or synaptic activity or sleep spindles? Or is it the physiological process which is producing some brain activity where I experience some dream? And in the Crick and Mitchison's hypothesis, they think it was a kind of a spillover effect, namely the last version of it. But we don't know exactly which of these two processes which are most important. We don't know it yet. But we know that both slow-wave sleep and REM sleep is very, very important for these two things. So if I should sum up this, I would just say the function of sleep is for body growth. It is for keeping, I didn't show data on that, keep the immune system active, but also for facilitating memory consolidation. And then I would also mention that in some species, not that much in humans, it has also an ecological factor. We downregulate metabolism to spare energy where we're not able to collect data. In the end, I just want to mention a few other things where it actually also has some importance. If we look at need of sleep and the ability to work without conflicts, this is a study in doctors. So, it is shown, for instance, among medical doctors, they make much more errors if they don't sleep properly. If they don't sleep enough, they tend to make more errors. So think about it when you meet a doctor in the nighttime. But it has actually consequences. Some of these experiments meant that a number of procedures were actually moved to daytime to avoid sleep, and this is a very interesting thing. It's great. It's really great. So, and I just want to, in the end, just to show you, when you say, oh, what about the chronic sleep? Does it really matter? But we have huge data, and this is also part of the research also in Denmark, where we actually look, what is the consequences for health if you don't sleep? And this is just something I want to show you. Obesity is related to less sleep. If you sleep, don't sleep enough, you tend, there is a high risk of being obese. And if you look at the risk of cardiac disease, there's also a higher risk of cardiac diseases here as measured by hypertension. And if you look at mortality, there's a higher mortality among those who report short sleep. And this is a huge study done in the San Diego area in the United States. So there are a number of studies who actually show this very interesting relation that short sleep are associated with increased morbidity and mortality. Strange enough, what we don't know is why people who sleep very long has increased. We think that there tends to be more sick. We don't know that for sure. Another thing, just to make sure, because don't think you will ask me, oh, I don't sleep very much, so should I sleep more? And the easy answer is yes, sleep more. But but how? I mean, researchers, they are horrible. But we talk about association, but that is not the same as causality. So that is not the same, and we don't know whether if we say to people, oh, sleep more, whether we actually can prevent some diseases. This is an open question, so we don't know. No. And lastly, just to make it short, we know that there are a number of effects of short sleep and in chronic ways, on cognitive effect, on physical effect, and so forth. But we still need to do more research whether we can use this information for preventive measures. So I will just summarize here that the brain is a complex thing, and there is highly regulating our wake and sleepiness, and we believe that sleep present a very, very important function, which include metabolism, energy preservation, and memory consolidation. But the problem is that you cannot sleep beforehand. If you want to sleep, you say in the next week, I need to stay awake. If you take the model, the two-process model, which I showed you, you are not able to sleep beforehand. And you have to think about circadian and homeostatic mechanism. And we believe that there is a minimum amount of sleep which is needed for health. So this is what I want to say here. I know it's complex, but I know that it's also very much interest about it. Thank you.